This lecture is going to be about the effect of air resistance on projectiles. Air resistance is the force of air on objects moving through it. The more velocity an object has, the more air pushes back against the object's velocity. So in this case, we can imagine the space ball getting faster and faster through the air in this direction, and as a result, the force of air resistance gets bigger and bigger on the ball. So air resistance is always working perfectly against the direction of the velocity. So if the velocity is pointing in this direction, the air resistance will push back up in this direction. This creates a pattern where the faster an object is moving through the air, the more it is accelerated in the opposite direction, because air resistance is pushing it back, and there's usually nothing pushing it forwards. So if it starts off moving fast, it's rapidly slowed down, because there's a lot of force of air resistance on it. But as it loses velocity, the air resistance also goes down, which means that the force slowing the object down is itself getting smaller, so it actually slows down at a lower and lower rate. So it takes longer to slow down if you're moving at a slower velocity through the air. So the rate of slowing itself slows down as you slow. A lot to take in there. Hopefully this visual helps a little bit. We can see the effect of air resistance on the shape of the path of projectiles. This is an example of an object moving without air resistance. And the noticeable thing about an object moving without air resistance is that it forms the shape of a perfect parabola. This is because its motion in the x direction is constant, and its motion in the y direction is symmetrical. Whatever it's doing on one side, it's doing the opposite on the other side. And so another thing that's noticeable here is that the displacement for the first half of the object's motion in the x direction is perfectly equal to the x direction displacement in the second half of its motion. It's symmetrical in that way. So if you see an object that's moving parabolically that's perfectly symmetrical, you know that there's no air resistance applying on the object. Now let's apply air resistance to this ball and see how its motion changes. So you'll notice that the path is different. It doesn't go up as high and it doesn't travel as far. And you'll also notice that it travels farther in the first half of its motion than it does in the second half of its motion. This is because as it moves forward, the velocity vector is being slowed down by the force of air resistance. So that means that it's moving slower in its second half of motion compared to the first. So in the second half of its motion, it moves less far in the x direction than the first. And the force of air resistance is also stopping it from going up as high. So you can see that the displacement in the x direction in the first half of its motion is much larger than the displacement in the second half of its motion, and it doesn't achieve the same height. So that will be the shape of projectiles with air resistance. We can also graph the motion of objects that are experiencing air resistance with position, velocity, and acceleration graphs. We normally only pay attention to the y direction of an object that's experiencing air resistance when we're graphing it. The x direction graphs don't really come up as much, so I'm only going to focus on those for this lecture. Let's start with an object that's free falling through the air, or it starts in free fall, but as it moves through the air resistance begins to pick up. So in the second that it's dropped, it's accelerating down at 9.81 meters per second, because in the second it's dropped, it doesn't have any velocity yet, so the only force acting on it is gravity, because no velocity means no air resistance up. And if the only force acting on it is gravity, that means that it starts with 9.81 meters per second squared of acceleration. And I'm considering the downward motion to be positive here, which is why that's on the positive part of my graph. But as it falls, it starts to pick up velocity very quickly because it has a large downward acceleration. So as it picks up velocity quickly, it also picks up air resistance very quickly. But as it gets more and more air resistance, it's also getting less and less total net force because the air resistance is working against the force of gravity. So the less net force it has, the less acceleration it has in the downward direction, which means that it takes longer to get more velocity, which means it takes longer to get more air resistance. So the more air resistance you have, the harder it is to get even more. So that's why the acceleration graph here is curving down. It starts off very easy to get more air resistance, so the acceleration rapidly drops off. But as you keep going, it becomes harder and harder to get more air resistance and add to that. This continues in this pattern until you hit a point where the acceleration finally becomes zero, where the air resistance balances out the force of gravity. And when this happens, this is terminal velocity. This is where the ball is moving at its fastest possible velocity and can't get any faster because the acceleration is zero because the forces are balanced out. So that point at the end of the graph is where terminal velocity occurs for the acceleration graph. We can also look at the velocity in the y direction for this object. We can imagine again that it's dropped, so that means that it starts at zero, and as it accelerates, it starts off gaining a lot of velocity in a little time, but as air resistance begins to apply to it, it becomes harder and harder to get additional velocity until the air resistance perfectly balances out the force of gravity. One way that we can understand this is to refer back to our acceleration graph. So I put the acceleration graph below the velocity graph to the left of my head, so you can look at what the graph's doing as you look at what the velocity graph is doing. Remember that the slopes of the tangent lines on a velocity graph represent the acceleration. So if the acceleration starts very positive but rapidly decreases, that means that the slopes of the tangent lines are also going to start very positive but rapidly decrease. But as they keep going, they're decreasing at a slower and slower rate. So they're getting to zero at a slower and slower rate as the graph goes on, until at the very end it finally hits zero. So the point where the acceleration is zero, that's where the velocity graph will have a flat slope, so it's just staying at that constant velocity. So that point there, that constant velocity, is the terminal velocity of the object. That y-axis value is the terminal velocity of the object. We can also look at the acceleration and velocity graphs of objects that are moving from one medium to another medium. Let's say, for example, that we drop this ball above the ocean and see what happens as it falls and then when it hits the water and moves into the water. So the second that we drop it, it starts off with an acceleration of 9.81 because the only force on it is gravity, and it starts with a velocity of zero. But just like in our previous graphs, these two graphs curve in this way until it hits its terminal velocity. So at the line that I drew, that's where terminal velocity happens on the graph, and that y value on the velocity graph is the exact terminal velocity of the ball in the air. So it hasn't hit the water yet, so it's going to continue to fall at that same terminal velocity, so the velocity is staying constant, which means that the acceleration is staying at zero. And then at this moment is where the ball hits the water. And when the ball hits the water, it's no longer feeling the force of air resistance pushing it up. It's now experiencing a buoyant force, which is the name for the force from water. And water pushes back on things much more strongly than air does. You know, it's much easier to move your hand through air than it is through water. So that means that suddenly there's a much larger force pushing up on the ball than there is pushing down. So that means that the net force is pointing up. So that means that the acceleration is also pointing up on this ball, which means that on my graph, the acceleration is suddenly going to jump into the negative value, because we're considering down to be positive, so up is negative. For the rest of the ball's trip, it's going to slow down, because the acceleration is pointing up while the ball moves down through the water, so that means that the acceleration is taking away from the velocity. So the buoyant force is going to shrink, because as you slow down, as the acceleration takes away from you, you're moving through the water less quickly, so the water is putting a smaller and smaller force back on you. So this is what the next part of the graph would look like. So it continues to slow until the buoyant force balances out the force of gravity. And when it does that, the ball is now at a new, smaller terminal velocity because it was slowing that entire time. And the forces are balanced, so the acceleration is now zero. So this is the new terminal velocity of the ball in the water. And if nothing interrupts that, it will just continue to fall at that rate until it hits the bottom. So obviously that graph is very complicated. If you watch this a few more times and try to take in every little bit of information, there's no one part of it that's especially challenging. It's just understanding everything that's happening that's a lot to take in at once. This exact same graph can also apply to other physical situations. Skydivers are really popular in physics when talking about air resistance. So when the skydiver dives out of the plane, the only force on them in the moment they dive out is the force of gravity, because they're not moving yet, so there's no air resistance. So that means that their acceleration starts at 9.81. And as they begin to fall, the force of air resistance gets bigger and bigger and bigger. So those first parts of the graph are the same as before, until the skydiver hits a terminal velocity without their parachute. And then they can fall at that terminal velocity for a certain amount of time. And let's say this is the point where their parachute opens. And the parachute makes their force of air resistance much larger because it has such a large surface area. So suddenly the net force is pointing up, which means that the acceleration is also pointing up, which means that because on my graph up is negative, the acceleration is suddenly going to jump to being very negative. So now that the velocity is still positive, but the acceleration is negative, the acceleration is going to rapidly take away from the velocity. And as the velocity gets smaller, the force of air resistance gets smaller until it balances out with the force of gravity again. And by that time, the velocity has gotten significantly smaller. So now the person is at a new terminal velocity with their parachute that they will maintain until they hit the ground. This is the reason why people use parachutes when they skydive. It's because when you open the parachute, you achieve a much smaller terminal velocity so you can land safely. You're not going to have to do specific math with these types of graphs. The important thing is to understand why the patterns in them are the way that they are, why they're curving in certain spots, why they're staying flat in certain parts, and what those curves and flat parts mean in relation to the forces and the velocities.